Okay, sir, so I start, right? Because it's
Yeah,
time
why not? Go
for
ahead,
a
please.
welcome all. Kindly mute your audio, please. Welcome in our 45th webinar on behalf of Government Arts and Commerce College Netrang, on behalf of my team and my honorable principal, Dr. G.R. Parma, I warmly welcome Dr. Amit Kapoor. I warmly welcome all the participants. Now the room is full. We are more than 98 people in web room. I will also request you, I will also send a link of our YouTube live, right? And it is our proud privilege that we have invited many personalities of India and many eminent personalities, right, from diverse field, including economics, literature, culture, journalism, and education, art, films, and language. They have addressed our webinars, and that's a very proud part of our webinars. We are now on 45th webinar, and it is you can say continuous journey. And today's topic is very amazing, very you can say debatable topic. It's a very good topic. The topic is about love in Shakespeare's Hamlet and Merchant of Venice, right? And our expert speaker is Dr. Amit Kapoor. He's associate professor and head Department of English, Sri JP Arts and Commerce College, Bharuch. We will provide you the link for YouTube live too. All right. It is also mandatory to fill your feedback, all right, before I say something. And so warmly welcome, sir. And it is our pleasure, right, when we read Shakespeare, we always read him as a poet of love. And love is his chief motive, right? I must remind that his sonnet, "Love which alters when it finds alteration is not love." And even in Hamlet, 40,000 brothers cannot sum up my love, right? I should also remind Robert Burns, because Robert Burns was one of the poets. His poems were also very useful during college days. "Oh, my love is like a red, red rose that newly sprung in June. Oh, my love is like the melody that sweetly played with the tune. As fair art thou, oh my Bonilla, so deep in love am I, and I will love thee still, my dear, that all the seas can dry. That all the seas can dry, my dear, and rock not with the sun. I will love thee still, though it's 10,000 miles." Oh, my God, it's youth, and it's poetry and it's love. So over to you, sir. What will you say on love? We will enjoy your shades, your shapes, your aspects of love, right? So today the webinar is on love, and I warmly welcome Dr. Kapoor, right, to address on Shakespeare's ideas, Shakespeare's concepts on love. Sir, over to you.
Thank you so much, Rathore sir, for those endearing words. At the very onset, I would like to express a deep sense of gratitude to Government Arts and Commerce College, Netrang, Bharuch, and to the entire team, especially to Dr. Rathore, and also our host today, Dr. Tanvir Ahmed, who has joined us like all the way from Kashmir, for giving me this opportunity, this platform to express my views, to share my views, and probably to have an interaction with all of you. So, respected participants, members of the academic fraternity, research scholars, and my dear students, a very good evening. And now, why I chose this topic, there are probably, you know, I can say a few reasons behind it. First is, we are in the times of pandemic, and probably I personally see that love as an emotion, or love as a quality, is probably the only saving grace which can probably save us from this, at least to some extent. It can bring us solace in this time of pandemic. And that was the reason why I chose this topic. And secondly, because I was talking about love, and I'm talking about love in the times of pandemic, and I was reminded of a very famous novelist, Gabriel Garcia Marquez, He wrote a novel titled Love in the Time of Cholera. You know, so it is like talking about something during a time when, you know, somebody is affected by some kind of illness or sickness, right? Now, to begin with, the title, as Jaswant sir has already, you know, talked about, he already, you know, has prepared the kind of much needed atmosphere. He talked about Robert Burns, and I was just going to add to it that Robert Burns is the one who is being reminded by all our college going students on the 14th of February every year, Valentine's Day, you know. So, okay. So to begin with, the topic that I'm going to share my deliberations on is the myriad shades of love in Shakespeare's Hamlet and The Merchant of Venice. Now, in fact, to talk of just love in Shakespeare would just be kind of giving a lopsided view of Shakespeare. But still, since I'm focusing on love, so, and I could not, in fact, you know, keep in mind the entire span of all the plays or all the works written by, or all the poems written by Shakespeare, because love is probably one of the most important themes in the works of Shakespeare, right? So to begin with, William Shakespeare, I'll not be, of course, focusing much on his biography, because I think almost all the participants here would be, more or less, even if they don't belong to, say, the English fraternity, if they are from other disciplines also, you know, they have more or less heard about Shakespeare to some extent, or have read Shakespeare somewhere or the other, maybe in translation also. Now, William Shakespeare is, in fact, the most widely acclaimed playwright and poet of the 16th century England, which was then ruled over by Queen Elizabeth. And, you know, especially writing love poetry was a fashion amongst the youth of the court of Queen Elizabeth. And this was the only means wherein youth could express their love for those ladies who were standing behind curtains in the balconies to probably propose their love for them. Because that was a period in time when, you know, there was orthodoxy. So, you know, it was not like WhatsApp or all these things were not there. So because of that, you know, these young courtiers would write love poems and would read them aloud, would recite them. And that was the way of the making proposals, right? Now, again, to go ahead, love is one of the recurrent themes in whether it is Shakespeare's plays or it is Shakespeare's sonnets or his other songs that he has incorporated within almost all his plays. And as you all know that I need not, in fact, like it would just be a reiteration of what has been said by many about Shakespeare. Shakespeare has written around 37 plays. And these plays can be broadly divided into five categories. So he has pure tragedies. He has pure comedies. He has what are called tragi comedies or romance, romantic comedies, romances as they are called. Then we have chronicle plays, that is history plays. And we have the fifth is the Roman plays, right? So that is how these 37 plays have been divided. Now, out of these five varieties or types of plays, I decided to choose the two major ones for which Shakespeare is acclaimed, Hamlet, a tragedy, and Merchant of Venice, which is a tragi-comedy, or you can say it is a romance, or many people have even interpreted, which I'll be touching upon. It is called a bromance. You know, I'll be talking about it in the later part of my discussion. So coming back to our theme, love to Shakespeare has different shades. You know, even if you talk about his sonnets, the 154, and which I can even claim that it has been and it stands as a record today also, after so many years that Shakespeare has gone, that nobody, no poet in the world has even dared reaching that, you know, number where, you know, 154 sonnets, you know, are there, right? So what he talks about, love, is he looks at love as, you know, there are certain adjectives that you can think of. Love can be looked upon as unfair. Rator sir, could you go to the first, that is the second slide, please?
Yes.
And could you go for the screen share, sir?
Is it seen? Is it there, sir? No.
Yeah, the second slide is there, but you need to start the slideshow, sir. You could go to the slide.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, I think now more or less it would be visible to all the participants. Now it is full screen. Right. Perfect. Thank you. So Shakespeare looks upon love in its variegated forms. He looks at the unfair kind of love, love as something that is confusing, love as something that is crazy, love as something that is unpredictable, and of course, love as uncontrollable, which he expresses in his different plays and his different sonnets and poems. And what he does further on is he works upon this theme of love and he tries to blend and bring about an admixture of what is called courtly love, because as I just told you, the poetry that was written or the plays that were written by Shakespeare during the time, during the 16th century, even the playwrights were all courtiers, you know, and that is the reason that there is a reference to courtly love. Then there is a reference to unrequited love, that is the love that has not been fulfilled, and you will find some references to it in the later part of my discussion. Then we of course have compassionate love, and we have the physical or the sexual love, and he has done this blending with all the skill and heart, and has been able to give to his audience the best blend that he could. A love in Shakespeare is a force of nature. It is earthy and sometimes it is uneasy, right? So see, you know, there in one of his plays, he says the path of love was never so smooth, you know. So he's talking about, you know, that darker side. He's talking about the brighter side. And probably he's trying to incorporate as many and add as many meanings to love as he could, right? Could we go to the next slide, please? So in the next slide, you know, you will just have a reference to these two texts that I have taken up for discussion today. So on the one hand, as you can see on your, you know, on the screen, tragedy, that is Hamlet, and we have a comedy, The Merchant of Venice, two different forms, and thereby two different shades, two different set of characters, and two different, you can say, points of views regarding love that have been presented by Shakespeare. Right. Next slide, please. Now, I would like to, in fact, begin first with the tragedy, because as we all know that Shakespeare is known more for his tragedies. And Hamlet happens to be one of his most popular of his tragedies. Now, before I begin the discussion, this is just for those of you who probably might have lost touch or may not recollect. I'll just, in a nutshell, I'll tell you what the play is about, what is the plot. In a nutshell, I'll tell you about it. Hamlet is a play about a prince whose name is Prince Hamlet. And he is a scholar who is studying in the University of Wittenberg. And he has, when the play begins, he has come to attend the funeral of his father. It has been roughly 2 months that his father, that is King Hamlet, has passed away, and whereas all the other characters are almost out of that, you know, gloom or grief, Hamlet is still wearing his dark, you know, mourning cloak, the dark black cloak. He is still mourning, and there is a reason for his sadness, and those reasons, which we will discover, are also linked to the theme of love. So Hamlet has come to attend the funeral of his father. Gertrude is his mother, who has very hastily married Hamlet's uncle, that is King Hamlet's younger brother, Claudius. And that too, within less than 2 months of her husband's death. So what does that say about her love? That also we will be talking about. Hamlet himself is in love with Ophelia. Now, who is Ophelia? Ophelia is the daughter of Polonius, and Polonius happens to be one of the senior counselors in the court of King Hamlet. Polonius has a son, Laertes, right? And then as the story goes ahead, we find that in the very first scene, it begins on the palace walls of Denmark, and there are two petrified watchmen or guards who have been seeing the ghost of King Hamlet for the past few days. And they are so petrified that when the change of guard is taking place at almost midnight, the ones who are to join the duties are very afraid because they know that something supernatural, some supernatural agency is visiting, and that supernatural agency is seen walking on the walls or across the walls of the palace. And they report this matter to Hamlet, and Hamlet has come to Denmark along with one of his friends, Horatio, who is also a fellow scholar at the Wittenberg University. And because they are very close friends, he does not leave his friend at this hour of his sorrow, of his loss, and he is there to support him. So now these guards, when they report to Hamlet that they have been seeing the ghost and they are worried, and it seems that it is the ghost from the kind of gait, from the kind of appearance, it seems, they say, it seems that it is the ghost of that is the dead King Hamlet. And he probably wants to say something. He probably wants to share something with somebody. And when, say, Horatio tries talking to the ghost does not. And finally, Hamlet is shown, talking to the ghost of his father. And it is through his father's ghost that we come to learn, and Hamlet comes to learn that his father did not die a natural death. The reason behind his King Hamlet's death was Hamlet's mother, or King Hamlet's wife Gertrude and Claudius, they conspired. And what they did is, when the king and the queen, that is King Hamlet and Gertrude, were sleeping in an orchard, so when the king went asleep, Gertrude, along with the help of Claudius, poured mandragora. Mandragora is supposed to be a plant having poisonous stems. And the juice of that plant is poured into the ears of King Hamlet, and King Hamlet died that way. So he was and he was murdered. He was murdered. So he tells his son, and that also I'll be talking about the father-son relationship in the later part of my discussion. He expects that as a son, he should avenge his death, and he should kill his uncle, that is Claudius. He should avenge his death. So that is what the story, that is what the beginning part is all about. The remaining part of the play is just about inaction, or about the procrastination of Hamlet. He fails to act. He thinks. And the time when he has decided to act, it has been too late, because it has given King Claudius enough chance to secure himself, and probably to, in fact, prepare for the death of Hamlet. So that is how the play ends. And then on the other side, we have Ophelia, who, because Hamlet is busy with other things going on in his mind, he is not able to give proper attention or proper kind of affection. He is not able to exhibit that. And Ophelia feels a little offended, taken aback. And she gradually starts turning. She initially starts with something like sadness, sorrow, then depression. And finally, it is a suicide. She commits a suicide. She dies. So that is how, the play works. And at the end of the play, where, Laertes, the brother of Ophelia, he has been told by Polonius that, Hamlet is responsible for your sister Ophelia's death. So, and Claudius has also prepared Laertes to fight against Hamlet. So there is the famous, very famous gravedigger scene where Hamlet and Laertes are fighting, and that is how they also die. And even Claudius is killed at the end of the play. So this is about the kind of the plot that I have given you in a nutshell. Now, coming to the theme of the different shades, or the myriad shades of love in Hamlet. Now, the major theme of the play Hamlet is probably not love, I would say, but it is rather the possibility of love, or the desire to be loved. There is a feeling of wantedness. The characters want to be loved, and probably they fail to be loved. And that is what the tragedy is all about. So desire or love is the theme that is eminent throughout the play, Hamlet. The emotion of love, it lies at the core of William Shakespeare's most iconic, this is one of the most iconic tragedies of Hamlet, tragedies of Shakespeare, which came in the year 1603. Now, which are the different ways or forms in which love can be expressed or love is expressed by Shakespeare in his Hamlet? So we have on the one hand, the love of husband and wife. Herein we are talking about the love of Gertrude and Claudius, the man, woman, the husband, wife. Then we have mother, child. So there are, references to the Oedipal inclinations of Hamlet towards his mother. So mother, that is Gertrude, and child, that is Hamlet. Then we also have the father and son, that is father and son. There are in fact two shades that I'll be talking about. On the one hand, we have King Hamlet and Prince Hamlet. And on the other hand, we have Polonius and his son Laertes. So that is father-son relationship. Then of course, we also have one very important type of love that we find in this play is love between friends. And that is about the loyalty, right? So, love between friends, you will find between, one of them would be love between Hamlet and his friend Horatio. And secondly, Hamlet and two very minor characters though in the play, but they play a very important role as far as, the journey of Shakespeare's revenge motive is concerned. They are Rosencrantz and Guildenstern, right? So, and lastly, we have passionate young lovers. Of course, there are certain young couples about whose loves the playwright has talked about, right? So there are, in fact, I have divided my study of the theme of love in Hamlet into four different rubrics or the four different shades of love that I find. Firstly, we can talk of romantic love, right? Then we have fatherly love, as I have already highlighted it earlier. Then we have motherly love, the mother-son relationship. Fatherly love is father-son relationship. And love as loyalty, that is love in the sense of, friends, right? Can we go to the next slide, please, sir? Okay. Now, if you look at the romantic love in Hamlet, again, within romantic love, there are two plots or two stories or two, that is two pair couples that we can talk of. One is the young romantic couple, that is Hamlet and Ophelia. And on the other hand, we have Gertrude and Claudius, the elderly couple, right? Next slide, please. Now, first, let us talk about Hamlet-Ophelia relationship. Now, Hamlet's love towards Ophelia is known at the very beginning of the play when he is writing letters, and these letters are read out by Polonius. And see, I'm quoting from the play. I quote, he says, the letter goes thus, I'm reading Hamlet's letter. Doubt thou the stars are fire, doubt that the sun doth move, doubt truth to be a liar, but never doubt I love. Oh, dear Ophelia, I am ill of these numbers. I have not art to reckon my groans, but that I love thee best, oh, most best, believe it. This is from Act 2, Scene 2, lines 115 to 21. What is he trying to tell her is that, you may doubt the stars in the sky. You may doubt the sun may not come tomorrow. You may doubt a person to be a truthful person may turn into a liar, but do not doubt my love. My love is like, permanent. It is eternal. It is unmovable. Nobody can change it. And then he says, oh, dear Ophelia, I'm ill of these numbers. This is a reference to the kind of pain, to the kind of sorrow, and probably the kind of shock that Hamlet has received on two counts. First is he has lost his father, whom he loved dearly. And second and most disturbing is the fact that he loved his mother, Gertrude. And therefore, the main reason for Hamlet's sorrow is the hasty marriage of Gertrude. And therefore, he has thoughts in the play, there are references where he is contemplating a suicide, you know, and that is why he says, I am ill at these numbers, you know, numbers meaning the number of years that I have spent. I am ill with this. Now I am fed up of life. That is what he is trying to say. I have not art to reckon my groans, you know. Now I don't even have words which can express the groans of pain, the pangs that I feel within me, but that I love thee best. So he's trying to get an assurance from Ophelia that you are my only saving grace. You are the only one whom I love, who you are the only one whom I am looking forward to as a kind of solace in this time of, in these testing times. So, but I, that I love thee best, most best. Now this kind of language, you know, which Shakespeare was known to have introduced, like we generally don't use two superlatives together, but he has done that, you know, double superlatives he has used, most best, believe it, right? So this is, we as readers come to know that the theme of love gets introduced, gets incorporated within the rubric of the plot of the play. Then Claudius's relationship to Gertrude is the soul of Hamlet's distrust of marriage and love. Now, this is what I was insisting upon. Hamlet has, as we all know by now, which is a well-established fact, has Oedipal, he suffers from Oedipus complex. He has Oedipal inclinations towards his own mother, and he cannot bear that his mother is sharing a bed with some other man, right? So Hamlet explains his problem with marriage by alluding to Gertrude as a breeder of sins. He loses his anger on Ophelia and says, now why is he losing anger on Ophelia? He's not actually losing his anger on Ophelia. He is losing his anger on Ophelia because at the back of his mind, he is looking in Ophelia, he is looking at Ophelia as his own mother Gertrude. He sees Gertrude in her, and therefore he ends up getting irritated with her. And this happens in the third act of the play, wherein this very popular kind of speech of Hamlet, wherein he tells, Ophelia, he says, get thee to a nunnery. Why wouldst thou be a breeder of sins? I am myself indifferent, honest, but yet I could accuse me of such things that it were better my mother had not borne me. Now look at the pain that he's feeling. He's telling Ophelia to get lost, literally, to get out of his sight, go thee, get thee to a nunnery, you know, become a nun, you know, abstain from this worldly life, which is full of materialism, which is full of pleasure, and go and become a nun. Because if you are a part of this life, this materialistic world, you will become as lustful as my mother Gertrude has. And just as my mother Gertrude is a breeder of sins, you shall also become a breeder of sins. I am myself indifferent, honest, you know. So he's in a way trying to tell Ophelia that please don't trust me. I can, you know, I don't have a fixed kind of, you know, thought process. I am disturbed. So I'm indifferent, honest. I may be honest, I may not be honest. But yet I could accuse me of such things that it were better my mother had not borne me. Now he's cursing, you know, he's cursing his mother. He's telling the Ophelia that it had been better I had not been born, and especially from the womb of such a lady as Gertrude, because I literally detest her, you know. So he literally hates her like anything. I am very proud. Now these are all the qualities that you find in Hamlet, right? So he says, I am very proud, revengeful, ambitious, with more offenses at my beck than I have. See, he's trying to, in a way, he's trying to warn Ophelia that if at all our relationship does fructify, we do end up getting married, we are not going to become a good couple because I have these qualities of being proud, I am revengeful, I am ambitious, and I have more offenses. That is, I have more defects than, virtues, you know. I have more vices than my virtues at my beck than I have thoughts to put them in, imagination to give them shape, or time to act them in, right? So This is because, as I told you, this comes as a reaction to Hamlet's excessive love for his mother. And the quote that I have taken is from Act 3, Scene 1, lines 121 to 130. Right? Can we go to the next slide, please? So in continuation, we again have a reference to Hamlet's love towards Ophelia towards the end of the play in the very famous gravedigger scene. And we have this very oft-quoted kind of line, which even Jaswant sir mentioned at the very beginning. Hamlet does admit his love towards Ophelia, even despite the fact of having lost Ophelia. Ophelia is being buried. You know, they jump into Laertes and Hamlet jump into the pit where Ophelia is to be, buried. And that is where, when the fight is taking place, Laertes says that I, as a brother, I love my sister. What do you know of love? He tells Hamlet. And then as an answer to it, Hamlet says, and I quote, "I loved Ophelia, 40,000 brothers could not with all their quantity of love make up my sum. What will thou do for her? What can you do for her, Laertes, as a brother? I can," this is again an example of one figure of speech, which is hyperbole or exaggeration, as we say. He says, "I love you, 40,000 brothers like you, Laertes, would have loved your sister, could not with all their quantity." Even that would have been, I love her more than that. You know? So this is a quote taken from Act 5, Scene 1, lines 262 to 264. Now, we have already talked of Hamlet and his views and his attitude towards love. Now let us go to the other side. Let us look at what Ophelia and how she looks at love and how she, evaluates love, or how important is love to her. Ophelia stands as a contrast to Hamlet, since Hamlet, we have already known about Hamlet till now, Hamlet may not be that much in love with Ophelia as Ophelia is in love with Hamlet, right? So Ophelia stands as a contrast to Hamlet, since she is truly in love with Hamlet. But since Hamlet does not give her the time and attention, she gradually starts losing the mental framework and she becomes mad, she drowns and dies. So this is the kind of tragedy that takes place with her. She is seeking, she is desirous of love. Not that Hamlet is not. Hamlet is also desirous of love. He desires love. He expects love from Ophelia. But then Ophelia, as daughters were supposed to be, performing functions of a loyal daughter. She could not go against the wishes of Polonius. Polonius was an elderly person, and he expected that his daughter should not somehow love Hamlet, because as we all know that Hamlet feigns madness in order to take his revenge against Claudius. He feigns madness, and therefore Polonius starts thinking that Hamlet is actually mad, and why should I marry my daughter to a madman? And therefore he forces Ophelia to he tells Ophelia that you stay away from Hamlet because Hamlet is a madman and you cannot marry a madman. But Ophelia, on the other hand, has a desire to be loved. And again, Hamlet is not giving her the time and attention. And finally, she goes in depression and she loses her mental framework, turns mad and drowns and dies. Their story, if you look at Hamlet-Ophelia love story, is actually a tragedy. That is where tragedy gets actually, fully expressed in this love story of Hamlet and Ophelia, because of the possibility of love that never really was. And if it is romantic, if you call it romantic love, then it is romantic with a tragic capital R. Right? So that is Hamlet-Ophelia love story. So the play is not about love, but the unfulfilled or the unrequited or the desired love, the characters desire and they don't get the love, which neither Hamlet nor Ophelia is able to get. So this is where, the first part of romantic love, the first, part of my discussion comes to an end. Now we go to the second part, next slide, wherein we have the love story of the elderly couple, the king and the queen, that is Gertrude and Claudius, in the next slide, right? Now, Gertrude, as we all know, the mother, an elderly woman, Gertrude has hastily married. Rator, sir, could we go to the next slide, please? Gertrude hastily marries Claudius within 2 months of her husband's death. Now, what does this probably show about Gertrude's character, right? It clearly indicates that Gertrude was not at all loyal to her husband. And that is the reason. It is because of her incest, or it is because of her love towards Claudius, that she conspires with him and plans a conspiracy wherein she murders her own husband. And that is the only reason why Gertrude could be looked upon as the so-called character with negative shades. You know, she has her own defects. Now, this comes as a shock. The hasty marriage of Gertrude. Hamlet was already disturbed because of his father's untimely, or rather, shocking death. It came sudden death, I would say. But he is more disturbed by the fact that his mother ended up getting married to Claudius, whom Hamlet did not much like. Hamlet did not like his uncle. You know, you have your own choices. Even when you are talking about your own uncles and aunts, there are certain uncles or aunts who are your favorites. And there are certain others whom probably you are not very, I wouldn't say you hate them, but you are not very comfortable with them. You don't open up with them, you know, so that is the reason. So this hasty marriage of Gertrude to Claudius comes as a shock to Hamlet. And then towards the middle part of the play in Act 3, you have this famous quote where, there is something that is expected out of Gertrude. Now, Gertrude is a grown-up woman. She's a grown-up lady. She has a young son, of a marriageable age. And she should be sensible enough. She should have her own gait. She should have her own poise. You know, that is what is expected out of people. Now, we have this dialogue where we find that she is not, actually what she is expected to do, what the social norms expect out of her. So I quote, "You cannot call it love, for at your age, the heyday in the blood is tame. It's humble and waits upon the judgment." This is the son telling the mother that you better, mend your ways. What you are doing is not correct. It is not, it does not go with the, it is not a dignified act that you have, married another person. Had you married a little later, it would have been okay, probably. But then marrying hastily was objectionable to Hamlet. And therefore he says, this, your love, you cannot call it love, because at your age, that is the age at which Gertrude is, the heyday in the blood is tame. That is, people become milder, softer, maturity is there, right? And it humbles you down and waits upon the judgment. You are mature enough to judge what is good and bad for you. And you did not think twice that you have lost your husband just 2 months back and you have ended up getting married to Claudius. So that is shocking to Hamlet. Gertrude acts quite contrary to what is expected out of her age. Now, this is what is expected. She should be humble, she should be tame, and she should act as a mature lady. What she does is Gertrude acts quite contrary to what is expected of her age. She is shown frolicking around Elsinore Castle like a schoolgirl. You know, it is as if like love at first sight, a girl falling in love and, jumping, and like in Hindi movies, they show, Pehla Nasha, Pehla Khumar, something of that sort. I'm reminded of that song. And she is, in love like a schoolgirl. She behaves much beyond her age. For Gertrude, love is a blinding, reckless emotion, uncontrollable, uncontrollable love. It is her error of judgment that leads the family and also the entire kingdom to its doom. She is responsible for not only the end of her own family, including her own husband, who was King Hamlet, who is King Claudius, his son and his daughter-in-law to be, and all the other characters. They are, they die at the end of the play. So the entire kingdom is lost, the entire family is lost just because of her error of judgment. Now, there is a striking difference between these two romantic love aspects that I have talked about, which is more or less clear in my discussion also, that Hamlet Ophelia and Gertrude Claudius, their love story, has a striking difference. If you look at Ophelia, as I have already mentioned in my earlier discussion, that Ophelia is supposed to be, is looked upon, as many critics have also vouched for it, that she is an epitome of purity. She stands for the pure love, you know, pure romance, pure love. Whereas Gertrude, on the other hand, she represents or manifests lust. So that is another shade of love, the sexual or the physical love that Gertrude, you know, manifests in the play. So this is the prime difference between these two romantic shades of love that, you know, we have with us, in front of us, right? Moving on now to the second, you know, shade of love that Shakespeare has talked about. And that is, could we go to the next slide, sir? That is the fatherly love, right? That is the father-son relationship. Now, when we look at the fatherly love or the father-son relationship, we find that the play Hamlet juxtaposes two father-son relationships. On the one hand, we have Hamlet and King Hamlet, the relationship of King Hamlet and Hamlet, the father and the son. And on the other hand, we have Polonius, the father, and Laertes, his son. So there are these two, you know, pairs that we can juxtapose, right? You can keep them side by side. These, one is the main plot and the other is, you can say, the subplot of the play. King Hamlet's ghost tells Hamlet, now this is like a father giving an advice to his son. And after having revealed the secret of his murder to his son, as you can see from the, you know, that illustrated picture that I have used in my slide, that is Hamlet who is trying to talk to is the ghost of his father. He says, and I quote, this is from Act 1, Scene 5, lines 23 to 25. If thou dost ever thy dear father love, this is King Hamlet telling his son, revenge his foul and most unnatural murder. You should end up, if you love me truly, Hamlet, then go ahead, avenge my death and kill your uncle Claudius and punish your mother, because they are the ones who are responsible for my death. Vengeance as a test of loyalty of the son towards father. Now, this is an incident where we find that vengeance becomes the motif for proving loyalty on the part of the son. The son has to prove his loyalty towards his father, keeping the vengeance motive in mind, because he has been probably informed by his father, he has been told by his father to avenge his death. And like the 16th century norms were such where, you know, the son, and especially sons from the royal families, the princes, would have no say. When the father says, do this, it shall be done. It is like the, you know, biblical reiteration of, you know, how things work. Hamlet is therefore torn between proving his love for his father and his duty to submit to the divine rights of the kings. Now, this is his problem. And this, you can say, is the hemartia in Hamlet. He's torn. He has, as his father has asked him to seek revenge, to avenge his murder. And as a loyal son, he has to avenge his father's death. Sir, could we go to the slide, earlier slide, please? So Hamlet, on the one hand, has to avenge his father's death. But on the other hand, what he has to do, what action does he have to perform? He has to go and kill King Claudius. Now, in order to kill King Claudius, Hamlet cannot kill King Claudius on two counts. Number one, Hamlet, though he may like or he may not like Claudius, Claudius is the father of Hamlet. And killing father or patricide was and is still considered one of the greatest sins. It is a sacrilege, basically, killing the father. So he could not kill Claudius because of this. Second, if Hamlet killed King Claudius, he would be killing the king of Denmark. By doing so, by killing the king, Hamlet would have been proved a traitor. And he would have been put behind bars and probably beheaded and or hanged to death. You know that. So he could not do so because of these two prime reasons. And therefore, this is the reason for his procrastination. He's torn between his loyalties, his loyalty as a son and his loyalty towards the nation, you know. So that is the reason for his pain, for his sorrow. Now, looking at the relationship of that Polonius shares with his son Laertes, Polonius also happens to be the father of Ophelia. They are from one family. Polonius is the same elderly counselor of the king, and he has to bear the sorrow of his daughter's insanity, which ultimately leads to her death. So as a father, he feels pain. Not that Polonius sees the death of his daughter. He dies much before that, of course. But then while dying, he does, or even when he was alive, he would just tell his daughter. And at the same time, he would tell his son after his, after he found out that Hamlet was had lost his sanity. Hamlet was, because he was acting insane. So he was feigning madness. So Polonius has to bear the sorrow of losing his daughter in pain, you know, and later, towards the later part of the play, we find that Ophelia ultimately dies. He is the one, that is, Polonius is the one who instills in Laertes, the son, the idea that his sister Ophelia died because of Hamlet, and hence he should avenge her death. So see, the motives for both the sons is the same, vengeance motive, right? Hamlet has to avenge the death of his father, and Laertes has to avenge the death of his sister. So that is a parallel as well, and there are striking differences as well. In both the cases, love leads to the doom of the cast. Ophelia dies, Polonius is murdered by Hamlet, though mistakenly, but then he is killed by Hamlet. Laertes and Hamlet are also killed, and so is Claudius, you know, so that way. So almost all the characters, for the sake of love, they get sacrificed, you know. So this is about the fatherly love or the father-son relationship. This was the second shade of love that I found in this, that I discovered in the text, Hamlet. Now moving on further to the next slide, where I'll be talking about the motherly love, that is the mother-son relationship. Can we go to the next slide, please? Now, when we talk of motherly love, we are precisely talking about Hamlet and his relationship with his mother, Gertrude. Now, after the loss of his father, you know, Hamlet loved his father very much. And after losing his father, Hamlet is probably desirous of love from his mother. He expects a little more love from his mother. And because of that, you know, it is primarily because he suffers from Oedipus complex. And Hamlet tells Gertrude, and this comes when it is night, and Gertrude tells his son that now I should go, and I have to go and I have to sleep. And that is where Hamlet tells Gertrude, oh, throw away the worser part of it and live the purer with the other half. Good night, but go not to mine uncle's bed. Now see, there is a clear indication that Hamlet is getting disturbed by even thinking of the fact that Gertrude is going to share the bed, is going to, you know, copulate with another man. You know, assume a virtue if you have it not, that monster. Now, who is this monster? This monster is this devil that he talks about. He is referring indirectly to Claudius. He says that monster custom, and then he changes. You know, he says custom, who all sense doth eat of habits, devil is angel yet in this. You know, stay back. Don't go to your bedroom. Don't go to bed. You know, you will stay an angel here. If you go to that devil, you know, that monster, you will also become a devil. You will also become a monster. The Gertrude-Claudius relationship can be seen as a perversion of love. You know, it is a pervert love, Hamlet might not even, or even audience in during Hamlet's time, or people during Hamlet's time, would not even have thought of what is Oedipal complex, because these things come much later. But then these are modern renderings, modern readings of the text, where we have a perversion of love. Their love story is a perverted love story, a component of sin, and therefore a component of sin. The prime reason for Hamlet's absence of love towards Ophelia is because of his Oedipal inclinations towards his mother. Now, this is the prime reason. Neither can Hamlet get love from Ophelia, Neither can he get loved by Ophelia, nor can he get love from his mother. And that is the reason for his dilemma. That is the reason for his pain or sorrow. Now moving further to the next slide, where we have the last shade of love, which according to, now I don't claim that this is the be all and end all of all the shades of love, that there might be many. You could think about many other shades of love. You could come up with several other things, but this was my interpretation to it. So this is the fourth type of shade, that of love that we talk about in this or come across in this text, Hamlet, is love as loyalty, loyal love. You know, another shade of love that Shakespeare depicts in Hamlet is loyal love. You know, and especially we have the love that is shared between Hamlet and his so-called best friend Horatio. Now Horatio, as I told you at the very beginning when I was telling you about the plot, Horatio happens to be a fellow student, a roommate of Hamlet at the Wittenberg University. And as a true friend should, he does not leave his friend in his time of sorrow, and he's there to support him. He's there to give him the kind of moral courage which is very much needed at the time when you lose somebody, right? So on the one hand, we have Hamlet's love towards Horatio. During his hours of sorrow, Hamlet cannot trust anyone besides Horatio. Horatio is the only one whom he trusts. He does not, he is skeptical about others. You know, he does not have trust in any other person but Horatio. Horatio too, not that only Hamlet is loyal towards Horatio. Horatio is equally loyal. Horatio too stands as a pillar of strength for Hamlet. He is to be seen as the sane who is mentally, whose mental equilibrium is maintained. You know, he has his own temperament. He controls all his emotions. And he is therefore, because he is sane, he is able to give sane advice to his friend Hamlet. And he is the one who drives him to action. Whatever action Hamlet decides to take, whatever vengeance, whatever revenge he has to take, and the, you know, play within a play that we have, which is called the mousetrap, you know, that also Horatio is responsible. Horatio, you know, helps him a lot in driving him to action, because Hamlet, as most of the critics also have said, is a man of words, not of action. He procrastinates. He does not act. So he helps him in taking, in probably transforming his thoughts into, putting them into action, and drives away his suicidal tendencies, because at times Hamlet feels like committing suicide, but it is only Horatio who comes to his saving grace, and he saves him from all these suicidal thoughts. So this is one aspect of loyal love. The second aspect of love as loyalty in love is the relationship that Hamlet, and therein we see Hamlet as a great magnanimous kind of character. You know, Hamlet is not only, he not only loves and respects the elders or people from his own cadre, but he also shares the equal kind of love and respect for even the minor characters, you know, the minor people. There are two very minor characters in the play, Rosencrantz and Guildenstern. Right, two very minor. They are like, almost like clownish characters, characters who were very much used by Shakespeare in most of his plays. Through their buffoonery, they would make audience laugh. And especially comic relief was looked upon as an important aspect by Shakespeare, and he incorporated this element of comic relief. So through these two characters, there is some element of comedy that is added to the play. These two minor characters, Rosencrantz and Guildenstern, are actually appointed by, you can say, or assigned a duty by King Claudius to spy on Hamlet. Because see, Claudius knows that he has done something gravely, seriously wrong. He has committed a sacrilege, he has committed a sin, right? He knows that he is a murderer. And he is afraid of the fact that his reality might get revealed, and therefore he wants to know what Hamlet is thinking about him, or what Hamlet is planning against him, right? And therefore he assigns, or he gives an assignment to Rosencrantz and Guildenstern, that you keep a watch, you spy on Hamlet, and you keep informing me. And that is what Rosencrantz and Guildenstern keep on doing. But one thing is there, that in Rosencrantz and Guildenstern's love towards Hamlet, one important thing is Rosencrantz and Guildenstern and Hamlet have played together as kids. They have grown together, right? They were like so-called bum chums, you know. They were like very good friends, you know. So they have been asked by Claudius to spy on Hamlet. That is, Rosencrantz and Guildenstern have been asked by Claudius to spy on Hamlet. Hamlet has grown up with them and hence shares an amicable relationship with them. He respects them. He loves them. He shows his, you know, love towards Rosencrantz and Guildenstern because they have, he had played with them as a child. But both, towards the end of the play, Rosencrantz and Guildenstern get killed just for the reason that they are able, in getting killed, they prove by both Rosencrantz and Guildenstern, they sacrifice their life, they get killed just because they love their friend for the sake of the loyal love that they share towards Hamlet. So these are the four shades of love that I have talked about in the first play of Shakespeare that I have taken up. Just to brush through what I have talked about, we have talked about the four shades of love. We talked about romantic love. We talked about fatherly love, the father-son relationship. Then we went on to the mother-son relationship. And lastly, we looked at loyal love. So these were the different shades of love as we see in the play Hamlet. Now moving on to the second text. Now this second text that I have taken up is one of the most anthologized, I would say, texts which has been, which has become a part of not only the college and university curriculum, but you will find that simplified, like Mary Lamb's, story renderings of the play would be found in being taught in the syllabi of certain schools and certain boards. You know, they keep this play in the story form, of course. Maybe some schools even take up, the drama form as well. But of course, it is a abridged kind of version. So, The Merchant of Venice, right? Now, again, before I begin with the discussion on the different shades of love or a particular theme of this play, I think most of you may know of the plot, but still, I feel that in order to connect and in order to bring home or drive home my point, I need to give a brief summary, you know, to The Merchant of Venice. The Merchant of Venice, as the title goes, is, as you know, the location of Merchant of Venice happens to be one of the romantic, comedies of Shakespeare. It was written in the year 1600, and when Shakespeare was writing his tragi comedies or romances, he made it a point that he would choose the setting of his play would be very far off places. Venice happens to be very far, and he chose such certain places for a certain deliberate reasons. We will not fall into that trap because that would consume a lot of my time, why he chose these distant places. So that could be another topic for another talk, which we can keep it for some other time. So as of now, The Merchant of Venice is a story about, to begin with, of two friends, Antonio and Bassanio, two very good friends. Both of them, Antonio is, of course, a well-established businessman. He is a merchant, as the title goes, and of Venice. And a news comes at the beginning of the play, news comes that a ship carrying the merchandise of Antonio has capsized at the sea. There is a sea storm and the ship has capsized and all his merchandise has been lost. That is the news that he receives. And he is saddened. Antonio is saddened by this fact. Bassanio, his friend, on the other hand, is hell-bent in love with Portia. Portia happens to be one of the most beautiful, women in and around Venice. And he happens to fall in love with Portia. Now, Portia comes from an affluent family, right? And Bassanio is not that rich, right? He cannot afford to please Portia with, costly gifts or exchange, clothes, or even himself wear such expensive things. And for that, he has this habit of borrowing money from Antonio. He has borrowed a lot of money from, and which I think almost all of us have done, many of us even do it now, that if you don't mind, asking if at all need be, if you require some money, maybe for something, you ask your friend, okay, you give it to me now, I'll, pay you later, So that. So he keeps borrowing money from Antonio Bassanio just to woo his lady love, just to win over the heart of his lady love Portia, right? Now what happens is, now Bassanio has decided to marry Portia, and Portia goes in for a kind of, there is the very famous casket scene, which many of you may know of, casket scene, where there are three different caskets, and in one of the caskets lies the ring, which if the person, there are many princes who have come, you know, it is like we used to have in India, we had this tradition of Swayamvar, you know, it is something of that sort, and whosoever is the right candidate who opens the right kind of casket, and Portia would marry that person. And it so happens that Bassanio is the one who is able to locate the right kind of casket, open it, and then, you know, they are happily married off. Now, the marriage of Bassanio to Portia comes as a kind of, again, to say, a kind of shock to Antonio. Why this shock? Yes, we'll be talking about it in one of the rubrics that I'm going to point out. Now, Antonio wants to help his friend anyhow for his marriage. He needs a lot of money. Bassanio needs a lot of money. And Antonio needs money. So he goes and borrows this money from a famous Jewish moneylender named Shylock. Shylock is a Jewish moneylender, right? And see, even in this play, you have the Christian-Jewish angle, which has been there since the time of the Bible. That angle has been touched upon by Shakespeare. And Jew is shown to be the so-called villain of the play. He's a moneylender who lends money to people, to innocent people, at an exorbitant rate of interest, you know, much beyond their reach. And that is how he is extracting money. And he gives this money on loan only, specially to Christians, because he very clearly says in the play that he hates Christians, right? And that is the reason why he gives loans to Christians and, you know, takes a lot of rate of interest that he, you know, takes from them is very high. But Antonio has to borrow. And he borrows roughly around 3,000 ducats. Ducats were gold coins or currencies that were prevalent in Venice in the time, the setting of this play, you can say. And the time period that is allotted. Now, when the money is given to Antonio by Shylock, a bond has to be signed by Shylock. And because Shylock is a Jew, he does not trust the Christian Antonio. He says that this bond shall be signed by your blood. And Antonio signs it with the blood. And what is written in the bond is, if you fail to pay back the money with the interest within 2 months from the date at which the loan is taken, I shall take away, that is I meaning in this context, Shylock, shall take away a pound of flesh from your body. Now this is the bond. He thinks twice, thrice, whether to do it or not. But Antonio loves his friend so much that he does sign the bond with his own blood. Now, during the course of the play, time and tide do not work in favor of Antonio. Antonio fails to repay the loan, to repay the interest, and he has to follow. And Shylock goes to the court of law to seek justice, because Antonio has failed to do what he was supposed to. And because it is a Christian judiciary where all the judges are Christians, Portia comes to, now Shylock is ready. He is, throughout the famous court trial scene, as it is called, he is shown sharpening his knife, you know, and he knows that he trusts the judiciary. He has faith in his judiciary, and he thinks that, yes, the judiciary would be working in my favor, and I'll be able to take away a pound of flesh from the body of Antonio. But at that point in time, Portia, under the guise of a male lawyer, a man lawyer, she comes there, and there we have the famous, one of the famous sonnets that Shakespeare has used in this play, The Quality of Mercy. wherein she tries to tell, that is Portia, in the guise of that male lawyer, is trying to tell Shylock, show Shylock the importance of mercy. And she tries to convince him that you should not be cruel enough to avenge, you know, to take away a pound of flesh. And that is where the play takes a turn. And the court does not only wipe away the loan of Antonio, but at the same time is cruel enough, I would say, according to, you know, the Christian, you know, if you go by the Christian thinking, is it gives out a verdict that Shylock has to turn or convert to a Christian. And not only that, Shylock has a daughter, Jessica, and Jessica is in love with Lorenzo, a Christian youth. They elope and get married. And Shylock is all the more furious because Lorenzo is a Christian. And he says that he loves his ducats more than his daughter, right? So the court also says that now all your wealth shall go to your daughter. You shall be left with nothing. So this is how, you know, it is like a loss for Shylock, double loss, losing his money, losing his interest, losing his daughter, right? And losing his religion. This is one of the most painful things which anybody could think of, right? So with this context, we, and at the end of the play, it is like every romantic comedy of Shakespeare, it is like, and they lived happily ever after. It is like that, when all the couples make merry, dance together, and that is how the curtain falls, right? Now coming to the theme of love, the different shades of love in Merchant of Venice. Love is one of the most important themes in, again, in this play, Merchant of Venice, which, as I told you, came at the beginning of the 17th century, 1600. It is, there is, in the play, you find an odd juxtaposition of love in the romantic sense, love as romance, and then love for wealth. There is a juxtaposition between the two. There are, just as in Hamlet, there were four shades of love, I have come across at least three shades of love in Merchant of Venice. First is almost similar to Hamlet. We have the romantic love. Then I am using a term, homosocial love, due to certain reasons, which I'll be coming to very soon. And the third is love for Luca, right? We'll be talking about them one after the other, right? Let us go to the next slide. First, let us see romantic love in Merchant of Venice. Now, love plays a very important role, as I told you in the earlier slide as well, in this play, Merchant of Venice. And when you look at romantic love, sir, go to the previous slide. There are three love stories in the play, right? The first is the story of Portia and Bassanio. The second is the story of two minor characters, Nerissa and Graciano. And the third is that of Jessica and Lorenzo, right? These are the three couples that we, young couples, lovebirds that we are talking about. So firstly, let us look at Portia and Bassanio, right? Now, when we look at Portia and Bassanio, they are, because they are a part of the main plot of the play, therefore they represent the highest form of love, right? Sir, previous slide, sir. Rathod, sir, previous slide. No, sir, previous one. Slide number, yes, this one, right, thank you. No, the one after it, the one after it. Slide number 14, sir, 14. It is Portia Bassanio. Before that. Yes, sir. Right. Perfect. Thank you. Okay. So Portia Bassanio love story, it is the highest form of expression of love. Though initially, Bassanio appears to be influenced by Portia's riches. Now see, Bassanio also, because he is not very rich and he has fallen in love with a rich woman, there are certain reasons behind it. Probably he wants to, he is eyeing the wealth of Portia. So he appears to be influenced by Portia's riches. But in the later part of the play, he proves to be a true lover who has been charmed by the numerous qualities of Portia, because slowly and gradually he starts discovering the qualities of his wife, Portia, that Portia is not only beautiful, you know, she's not only attractive to look at. She does not only hold physical beauty, but she has, say, intellectual and emotional beauty as well. Portia too is in love with Bassanio. Sir, the next slide, sir. Portia too is in love with Bassanio. When Nerissa reminds her of Bassanio, she remembers him fondly and agrees with her that he would be the most suitable husband for her. So Portia is being helped, like young girls, even these days, when college going girls, one of the girls has fallen for some guy, she would generally talk to one of her best friends, like is he worth it? Is he worth my love? Just to get a kind of confirmation that is it the right kind of guy? And that is what Portia is trying to get information from. She is asking Nerissa that is he okay? Is the right kind of choice that I have chosen, Bassanio? And therein we have, she says, I never did repent for doing good, nor shall not now, not now. For in companions that do converse and waste their time together, whose souls do bear an equal yoke of love, there must be needs a like proportion of lineaments, of manners, and of spirit. That is, there is a complete surrender. There is a complete surrender in love. That is what she is trying to say. She says that now, after having fallen in love with a guy like Bassanio, I don't repent having, done. There is nothing wrong in having chosen him as my husband. Nor shall not now, for in companions that do converse and waste their time together, whose souls do bear an equal yoke of love. See, equal yoke, balanced. Balanced love is very important. It should not be lopsided. Love has to be balanced. Whose souls do bear an equal yoke of love, there must be needs like a proportion. Love in a balanced manner, having proportion of lineaments, that is the garb that they wear, the kind of clothes, because it might happen, especially with the ones who are married now, who are listening to me. You always ask your wife, should I be wearing this for this occasion? Should I be wearing that? So lineaments. Then of manners, how you carry yourself, how you carry yourself, and lately of spirit. Love is not, the meeting of two bodies, but it is rather a meeting of two souls. So there is the aspect of that spirituality in love, that touch, that besides the physical touch, there is that emotional bonding that we have in love. And these lines are from Act 3, Scene 4, lines 10 to 15. Okay, over to the next slide, sir. Now, the two other couples that we have as that we come across in the study of romantic love, one of them happens to be Nerissa and Graciano. Now, Nerissa and Graciano are two minor characters, and they blindly follow their so-called masters, that is Portia and Bassanio. So their love story is a mere imitation of the romance between their master and mistress. There is no fervor or intensity in their love. They are just mimicking, they are just copying their masters. It is rather a kind of prosaic kind of love, for both of them are guided by common sense, right? So it is a pure love story, like nothing else. No bonding as such. They are blindly imitating, aping their masters and their mistress. Though initially Bassanio appears to be influenced by, this has come out of mistake. So now going on to the third romantic pair that we have of Jessica and Lorenzo. Now, Jessica, as I have already informed you, is the daughter of Shylock, the moneylender. She's a Jew, and she has dared, I would say, because 16th century was still a time when this religious divide was very much visible in the social fabric, right? So Jessica has dared, and that to a woman, protesting against the father and demanding her own kind of right to marry the kind of person whom she wishes to. And that too, she ends up getting married to, falling in love, not only falling in love, that would have been acceptable to some extent, but she elopes and marries. So eloping was probably a socially objectionable kind of act during the 16th century. She performs that. She's a daughter, she's a Jew, and she has eloped. These are the three major allegations, accusations, you can say, against Jessica. A true love. Their love of Jessica and Lorenzo is a true love that doesn't allow religious differences to prove an obstacle in their way. Religion does not come their way. Jessica expresses her love thus. She says, and I quote, I am glad it's night. Now, because a woman was not allowed to express herself, her love especially, publicly, and was not supposed to go out in public alone, because 16th century society, let me remind you, was an Orthodox society. As a daughter, the daughter had to be assisted always when she went out in public. She had to be assisted by the father or the brother. Then after marriage, it was the husband. And later on, it might be after marriage, the son. So she could not move out all by herself. And that is the reason why Jessica takes the garb of a man. She dresses up like a man just to save the glare of the society, just to save herself. And therefore, she is dressed up like a boy and she has gone to meet Lorenzo. And she says, I'm glad it's night. You do not look on me, for I am much ashamed of my exchange. What exchange is she talking about? The change of the gender role that she has inverted. She's, standing as a boy here. She has dressed up all like a boy. But love is blind. This is a very oft-quoted kind of proverb. You know, love is blind and lovers cannot see the pretty follies that they themselves commit. For if they could, Cupid himself would blush. Now look at, she is in fact talking about Cupid, who is supposed to, you know, hit arrows and make people fall in love. So if even Cupid would see me, probably he would blush to see me thus transformed to a boy. You know, I am such a good looking boy that even as a boy, if any girl would look at me, she would probably get attracted towards me. So this is again a dialogue from Act 2, Scene 4, lines 34 to 39. Now Lorenzo, who happens to be a Christian, is in fact, he turns out he acts as a catalyst to incite the hatred of Shylock. Why is Shylock becoming demonic in the court, especially in the trial scene? When once or twice, when the people, when the counselors are telling him to quieten down, you know, to probably take away that wife, that bond, which is very cruel, which is very inhuman, he still insists on taking his pound of flesh. All the more because he is probably saddened, and I would say he's hurt, he's wounded, probably his soul is wounded by the fact that his daughter, whom he loved so much as a father, has turned out to be has cheated on him. Because not only does Jessica elope, she has also robbed him of his wealth. While leaving the house, she has robbed a lot of money of her own father, and she has eloped with Lorenzo to have a happy married life. And therefore, Lorenzo acts as a catalyst to incite the hatred of Shylock towards Christians. And that turns him into a monster or a demon. And that is why he insists on taking his pound of flesh from the body of Antonio in the trial scene, right? So this is where the first, shade of love, the discussion on the first shade of love, that is romantic love, comes to an end. Now, moving further to the next slide, we have, as I was telling you, I have used this term, homosocial love. Now, what are we talking about? As I have already mentioned, the homosocial love is, we are talking about the love between two male friends, the intimacy that is shared between Antonio and Bassanio. Had it been the present time, we would probably have used something like, you know, homosexual relationship, because there are overtures and there are meanings, and there are, in fact, inclinations of Antonio towards Bassanio on those grounds. Antonio is, physically attracted towards Bassanio, whereas, so on the part of Antonio, it is a homosexual relationship. And why does Bassanio love Antonio? He loves Antonio not only for the fact that he is his friend, but he loves him more for the fact that he is like his bank. He is like his, like the source of the money, the much needed money, which he requires to win over Portia. So his love towards, that is Bassanio's love towards Antonio, is the social kind of love. And that is the reason why I have clubbed the two words, homosexual and social, and I'm using a word, homosocial love, right? Now, in the first scene of the first act, wherein Antonio, having lost his merchandise at sea, wears a gloomy look, right? He's saddened by the fact that he has lost a shipload full of his merchandise. And when asked the reason for his sadness by his friends, he admits that he does not know the cause of his sorrow. Actually, what is the cause of his sorrow? The cause of his sorrow is not only the loss of his merchandise, But it is more, Antonio is more saddened by the fact that very soon Bassanio will be married off to Portia. He will be going away and living away at a distance from him, away with his own life partner, which is not, in fact, acceptable to Antonio. He's not ready to, like Hamlet is not ready to share his mother, and Antonio is not ready to share his friend with his wife, that is Portia, Pisanio's wife, right? Now, when asked the reason for sadness by his friends, now there are certain friends, you know, Solanio is one of them, he's a minor character, one of the friends of Antonio. And the friends, even Bassanio is still not there. There are three friends, Solanio and two others, who are asking Antonio as a, you know, a considerate friend. You would ask, when your friend is sad, you would ask him, like, why are you sad, you know? So they are asking the reason for his sadness. And he says, no, there is no particular reason for my sadness. And one of the friends, you know, he does suspect that his friend, that is Antonio, is not sad because of the loss of his merchandise. There is some other graver and a much more different reason for his sadness. And Solanio suggests, why then you are in love? Are you in love? That is why you are sad. Are you in love with somebody? He is asking Antonio, are you in love with somebody? And that is the reason for his sadness. And then Antonio does not react to this. He does not react to what Solanio has to say. But soon Bassanio arrives on the scene. And this changes the entire conversation. And Solanio then remarks, and he tells his other friends, who are Graciano and Lorenzo, they are there along with Solanio. And he says, here comes Bassanio, your most noble kinsman, Graciano and Lorenzo. Fare you well. We leave you now with better company. Now see, there is a reference here that we are not as good friends to you, Antonio, as Bassanio is. So we leave you with better company. Right. So this is a dialogue that is taken from Act 1, Scene 1, lines 57 to 59. Just one, sir, just one thing. I think I have time.
Yes, sir, you have time.
Okay. Yes, sir, Thank you. Mm-hmm. Because I should not be pulling on too much. Okay. Okay. So further, Bassanio loves Antonio. Now, this is Antonio's love towards Bassanio that I have talked about. Now, we go to the other side. Bassanio's love towards Antonio. Bassanio loves Antonio for quite a different reason. In order to woo Portia, Bassanio spends a lot of money because Portia comes from an affluent family, and that is the reason he borrows money from Antonio at regular intervals. And now, because he has decided to get married to Portia, he needs a little more money because celebrations are going to be on. Antonio does not hesitate even borrowing money from Shylock, whom he doesn't like. Antonio does not like Shylock because Shylock is, after all, a Jew. So as a Christian, he does not like Shylock. And Shylock does not like Antonio because he is a Christian. But then Antonio needs money, and he cannot find any better option than Shylock. He goes to Shylock and borrows money from him, though at a very high rate of interest, just because he does not want to lose Bassanio. So herein we have the homosexual overtures of love of Antonio towards Bassanio. Thus, the love between these two friends is, that is Antonio and Bassanio, is homosocial. The word homo has been taken from the first part of the word homosexual, from the point of view of Antonio, and social from the point of view of Bassanio. So this is the second shade of love that we find in the play Merchant of Venice. Now, third and the last is, of course, very clearly, you know, evident in the character of Shylock, and that is the love for lucre. Now, lucre is another synonym for wealth or money, you know, which is in abundance, right? So he is an affluent moneylender, Jewish moneylender, Shylock. So the love for lucre, it gets well exemplified in the play. This theme of love for lucre gets well exemplified through the character of the Jewish moneylender, Shylock. He's passionately in love with his money. He is literally mad after his money. He's greedy and miserly. You know, now despite the fact that he has all the wealth that one could think of, still he is greedy for more money, And at the same time, he is very miserly. You know, he does not even spend on his clothes. You know, he wears a sack, you know, a robe made out of sack throughout the play. And that too, it is tattered at places. People keep telling him, you are a moneylender. You should be, you know, wearing something good. And he does not do so just because he is very miserly, right? He does not spend on his own, and he does not want to spend on even his daughter, right? For whom does he, though he loves his daughter very much, but still when it comes to spending money, you know, he has his own restraints and his own choices. Now, when Antonio fails to repay the loan within the stipulated time of 2 months, he demands, as per the bond that has been signed by, that he has got signed from Antonio, he demands a flesh of blood from his body. His passion for money incites his passion for revenge. And as I have told you in the earlier slide, that Christians are his target, Shylock's target, and he hates Christians. And especially there are two people who are responsible for it in the play. First was Lorenzo, with whom his own daughter has eloped, and she has settled down and married with Lorenzo. And this, the other one, of course, was Antonio, who, despite the fact that he has borrowed money from Shylock, is now not ready to repay the loan and also the interest which he is more interested in. Now, when his daughter, that is Jessica, Shylock's daughter, elopes with the Christian Lorenzo and robs him of his wealth, because as I told you that when Jessica eloped, when she left her father's house, she also, you know, took away some wealth from, you know, of his father and eloped so that she could have a secure and probably kind of comfortable married life. His anger knows no bounds. When he finds out that his daughter has eloped and that too with his ducats, he loses his anger. He wishes his daughter dead. See, a father wishing the daughter to be dead, you know, that could, no father could think of that. So this proves that he is actually a villain. Just a minute. Now, when he wishes his daughter dead and his ducats buried in her coffin, and that is what he expresses in this dialogue that I'm going to read out soon. Salanio expresses Shylock's sorrow thus. Salanio, he expresses his sorrow. He says, I quote, "I never heard a passion so confused, so strange, outrageous and so variable as the dog Jew did utter in the streets." Now see, this is a typical Christian talking about or expressing his views about a Jew. Jew is compared to a dog. So as the dog Jew did utter in the streets. And what are these? Then he reiterates the words that were spoken by Shylock on the streets of Venice. What are these words? He says, this is Shylock speaking. These are the words of Shylock. "My daughter, oh my ducats, and my daughter fled with a Christian. Oh my Christian ducats." See, he uses the term Christian ducats. How could my Jewish ducats become Christian ducats? He is more pained by the fact that not only is his wealth plundered or he's looted or he's robbed of his wealth, but he is more pained by the fact that it will now become the wealth of a Christian. So that is the main reason for his sorrow or sadness. So these dialogues are taken from Act 3, Scene 8, lines 12 to 16. So now, in this play, these three shades of love I have talked about, Merchant of Venice, we started with romantic love, within which we looked at three different young couples. We had Portia Bassanio, we had Nerissa and Graciano, and we had Lorenzo and Jessica love story. Then we looked at the homosocial kind of love, that is the love between two friends, which is not actually natural. It is something little unnatural, I would say, to some extent, or which is a demand of on the point of view of Bassanio, it is kind of social demand of a friend, a need of a friend. And then lastly, we have love for lucre or love for wealth. So this is where, you know, I would like to, you know, conclude by saying that love indeed plays a pivotal role. Sir, you can go to the next slide, sir. Love indeed plays a pivotal role in several plays of Shakespeare. Now, these are not the only two plays where Shakespeare has used love as a theme. Love is, you know, almost everywhere you'll find love, though different shades of love you'll find in almost every play or every poem of Shakespeare. He probably tried to incorporate all aspects of love, exhibiting his greater understanding of this universal emotion. In Hamlet, love destroys far more often than it creates. Love is as a destructive force. That is what we saw in Hamlet. It poisons, stabs, beheads, and ultimately brings down an entire kingdom. Whether you look at any shade of love that I have talked about, it only poisons, stabs, beheads, and ultimately, you know, ends up in, it is the destructive or the negative side of love that we find in Hamlet. But on the other hand, The Merchant of Venice presents the ideal of love's wealth, which increases by sharing. Love only increases by sharing. And the aphorism that we have, the famous Latin aphorism, which goes thus, amor vincit omnia, which means love conquers all, stands true in the case of this play, that is Merchant of Venice, because love actually conquers all, as we find in the play. So with this, I bring my discussion to an end. And thank you all for giving a patient listening. Now, I would be more than happy if I could have certain questions or suggestions or certain add-ons to what I have said. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Yeah, sir. Thank you very much for providing us different shades of love. Love in Shakespeare, I must say, and that he has described love as a vaccine in the time of COVID-19, right? So yes, it is there. I have one query regarding your description of Ophelia. Right? Okay. You have said that Ophelia loved more than, or her love was more, you can say, more serious than Hamlet's. Right? I found she as an immature lady in love, because she is used as a tool by her father, and that's why she is a green. She can be called a green lady, an immature one to be loved, right? Because he is engaged. This fellow is engaged in so much political affairs. And even in Hamlet, you can find that none can be reliable, right? Every because very in the very beginning, he finds that the most important or most valuable relationship is between the child and the mother. But that relationship is also violated. He has lost the love of the father, and he has also lost the love of a mother while that lady marries with the king. He tries to find out, as you said very rightly, that he tries to find out something called solace. And love for Hamlet is not, you can say, a kind of physical attraction, but it is a kind of intellectual solace. And that's why he tries to understand that girl, and when he understands that she is no more, you can say, capable of love, and that's why there is something called in modern terms breakup. Do you agree with me that she is not capable, she is not eligible for love?
No, to that, what I would like to say, you are absolutely fine, right? If you're talking about the intensity of love as compared to like Hamlet's intensity of love towards Ophelia, and on the vis-a-vis, that is Ophelia's intensity of love towards Hamlet, what I was trying to prove is Ophelia is a woman of the 16th century. And just as Hamlet is probably, he's provided with choices. He is torn between his duties as a son and as a, I would say, even as a, you can say, as a citizen of his country. Because as I told you, he cannot kill Claudius for these two reasons. He's torn between his duties. Similarly for Ophelia, she being a woman, that too of the 16th century, which was a very orthodox society, woman could not openly express her love towards the person whom she had fallen for, right? That was reason number one. Reason number two, daughters in the 16th century were supposed to abide, till the time they were married, they had to abide by the rules and regulations of the father. The father was the be-all and end-all of all decisions that the daughter had to take. And after the marriage, it was the husband, the male, it was a male-centric it was rather a chauvinistic kind of male chauvinistic approach that we see. So Ophelia, despite the fact that she did love Hamlet intensely, but the only thing is she failed to express it just because of the societal norms. That is the reason why we find her ineffective. And as you say, that she is found to be a little weaker. Not she is not weak, but the only thing is she is she's again torn, and she's trying to probably balance between her love for Hamlet and love for her father. That is how I would address to your question. I hope I have made sense.
Yeah, it's every opinion must be respected. So yours is also it's another shade of you can say interpretation.
Yes.
Second question is on Merchant of Venice. Do you find Shakespeare as a critic of Christian doctrines of you can say love thy neighbor? And can I say it very truly that don't love thy neighbor if he is a Jew? Am I right?
I would say yes to it to some extent, of course with certain limitations. The reason being, after all, you don't have to forget Shakespeare himself was a Christian, right? And therefore, he would have those inclinations, right? He would have thought of, and therefore he portrayed a Jew as a villain. That was the, why should, and even when it, like, if you look at it, this is of course not a part of the discussion, but just to, you know, digress a bit, I'm digressing a bit. If you talk about the title of the play,
I think someone has please mute. Yes, sir.
Okay. So, you know, when you talk of the title of the play, The Merchant of Venice, the question, most important question is, who is the merchant in the play? Because there are many contenders to it. Very obviously, most of the critics agree on the fact that Antonio is the merchant that we are talking about. But it could be Shylock, it could be Bassanio, it could even be Portia. She is a merchant in her own, trade, that is law, right? She is a merchant of her own kind, you know. So the term merchant itself has certain, you know, different variation. But when you talk of Shakespeare and he expressing the kind of Christian, that biblical kind of saying that love thy neighbor, probably, yes, I would to some extent agree to what you are saying. Yes, because after all and ultimately Shakespeare was a Christian and he could not openly say it, but then yes, he does portray Shylock as a villain just because Shylock is a Jew, right? So that.
Okay, sir, differing from you. Now I would like to differ from you. Okay. I will say about another perspective. Shakespeare, it seems that Shakespeare, though he was Christian, he was critic of a kind of racialism pervaded there in the 16th century, and that's why he portrayed a character of Jew, this character, and he also wants to expose how Christians behave with this Jew, and
yes.
that's why that can be one of the interpretations that he.
Oh no, you are
very
right.
He can be a critic of. He can be a critic of racialism. He can be a critic of miss, and he wants to explore that. Okay, this is the concept called love thy neighbor, and this is the Christian concept. And a true Christian must follow that doctrine of love thy neighbor. You should not deny yourself that. You should not have that concept in your mind that because he is from another race, you should not love, right? So it is a kind of differentiation. It is a kind of, you can say, categorization and division, right? He is critic of, and yours is very good. This webinar is very good. It is just, you can say, the introduction of our next international e-conference. I think that Tanvir sir is listening to us, right? And it is a kind of, you can say, introductory note, right, to the international e-festo of the international e-conference, right, is organized jointly by Tanvir sahab and me, right? Is Baba Ghulam Ali University and Jammu and Kashmir and Government College Nitrang. Okay, so you can you have oriented us, right, regarding this Shakespeare thing, because it is the title is celebrating Shakespeare. Yeah, Tanvir sir is Tanvir sir, please.
Amit,
yes,
sir,
please.
Enlightening,
yes, sir.
Speech.
Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Ask you a question
from
T.S. Eliot, who said that Hamlet is an artistic failure. So how do you respond to that?
Okay. See, T.S. Eliot's observations or his reading of Shakespeare was of a very different kind. You know, he talks about his own objective correlatives, and his entire point of view is very different, you know. Why he says so, and there are certain reasons for it, because probably if you look at certain writings of Eliot, you know, he had, say, for example, his famous poem, Love Song of J. Alfred Prufrock, you know, where he talks about failure in love, you know, that is one of the themes there. He is actually looking upon his own failures, and he's trying to manifest them in these characters. And when Hamlet fails, you know, it comes as a personal thing to him, and probably that is probably the reason why he says it is a failure. You know, that is my, you know, point of view of looking at Hamlet.
Agree to me that the new critic approach, you know, which came through this T.S. Eliot and later by I.A. Richardson, John Crute, and some, was one of the very narrow kind of an approach towards the literary texts.
Yes, I would agree to that. The reason being, see, the insistence in new criticism is they use the term close reading. Close reading. Now, there are different ways of interpreting the term close reading. Close reading is you close your eyes to all other aspects other than the text. Like Roland Barthes says, the death of the author, or even, you know, the text is the only thing which comes to the reader's hand. And that is the only thing that you have to, you can say, appreciate. As a reader, you know, as a student of humanities, right? But what I personally feel is, yes, close reading also means reading between the lines, right? By shutting yourself off to these facts that what are the socio-cultural or what are the historical backgrounds to a particular age, I think your interpretation of a text in a classroom could become a little lopsided. That is what I personally feel. Yes, there should be not an excess, but at least a bit of it. At least you can locationalize a text. You know, locationalizing a text is very important, because when we are dealing with literature, because literature, we all say, is a reflection of the society. So when it comes to reflection of society, the first question is, which society are we talking about, right? As a reader, you know, as an observer, as a student, you know, the first question would be, where does this writer belong? You know, that is, and therefore a bit of it is important. That is what I personally feel. The text alone, I don't think, because that would be very pure and prosaic kind of approach, and like a closed kind of reading, not broadening enough, right? Because now we are into a time when, you know, there are a lot of, we are into the multicultural approach, right? And multilingual approach. So I think our horizon should broaden rather than narrowing down. That is what my say to it is.
And sir, it is 90-50 kind of reading, right? We are in the 20th century. We must have some more interpretations, right? We must have some dynamic things, na? Because it is said in the world of computers or softwares, na? That every day the language changes. Right.
Yes.
So right,
yes.
Now we can also say about literature that every day the interpretation changes. We can also talk Shakespeare as a neo-capitalist. Right. We
yes,
can
yes.
discuss
Very
it
true.
Sometime. Right.
Very
okay.
True.
So is there
even,
is there
even,
any...
you know, the character of Shylock can be studied from the point of view of finance and economics. You know,
Yes, sir. So there are see, actually there are some books, right? They talk about Shakespeare and management, Shakespeare and economics. One can, because Shakespeare is a brand which can be sold or which can be marketed everywhere. And nowadays, sir, let me tell you, because I have read key concept, or you can say concept note of Tanvir sir. Everywhere you can find, sir, you can find that Shakespeare can be, he is a kind of discourse, right? He can be interpreted in any way, all right? And that's why there are many interpretations. And particularly in a day, you can find a new book coming out of that discourse. Or called Shakespeare. So on Shakespeare, you have one book published each day, right?
Yes.
And even Hamlet, though it is in Iliad's terms, it is artistic failure. But on Hamlet, there are, you can say, multiple articles. You can miss. I have pursued my research work, sir. I have pursued my research work on Shakespeare. I was so much confused about two things. What to take, how to take, what to read.
Right.
And how much to read. And one thing is very, very, you can say it was an impossible thing with me. And it was a very, you can say dire impossible, or a dire difficult thing for me was that if I write a sentence, that would go to plagiarism software. That's everything is plagiarized. Because in this discourse now, what you write can be written by someone, right? So
let me tell you, Rathod sir, this is also for those research scholars who are listening to me. Research is not about, you know, innovativeness. It is not innovativeness in the sense, it is not newness, I would say. It is not you cannot find anything new to literature. Because see, what even R.J. Rees and what other critics have said, love, life and death, these can be the only themes that are available to literature and one can only talk about them, right? Newness lies in being innovative. Your approach should be innovative. It is there around you. You need to find that out. That is the only thing that research is, right?
So, but my problem, my problem was also problem of language. For example, if I write some paragraph or a sentence or some sentences, if I upload that paragraph or that paper or that article in that software plagiarism finding software, right? Then it will say that, 70% is plagiarized. Oh my God, on Shakespeare, you cannot write an article. You have to be very careful. You have to be very meticulous while writing too. Is there any question from the participants? You can ask question. Please unmute your audio first.
Sir, the way this whole lecture was conducted by Amit sir, I would rather say here that those who were watching and if they are going to take a research, I bet that they will find 100 of topics based on these two plays only. One of the ideas that I got when you were dealing, because you were linking also the theory in between, when you were talking about, you know, Hamlet scolding Ophelia, when he called her to go to a nunnery, we can... Right. I think also, if you agree with me, classify that as a transference in, psychoanalytic theory, where are, you know, a kind of a projection.
Yes. Very true. Very true. Very right.
I believe those who have heard or listened this lecture very carefully, they can find out more than what, you know, you have said, because it was seriously, meticulously presented, sir.
Thank you, sir, for those endearing words.
Sir, there is one question in chat box and I find it very wonderful. Someone, Mr. Dr. Manish, right? He said that Shakespeare was romantic fool. Do you believe Shakespeare was romantic fool?
Yes, he was obsessed with love. Yes, because love is one of the predominant themes that he talks about. But to call him a fool, I don't think. If had he been a fool, we would not have been talking about him even after roughly 500 years after his death. So Yes, fool in the sense, because everybody who falls in love is a fool. That is what I personally feel. When you are in love, you tend to lose your probably, in sanity, I would say. So yeah, to that extent, yes, Hamlet, sorry, Shakespeare was a fool. And let me also add, like, which I did not probably say or refer to in my discussion, that there are readings which say that Shakespeare, there are two readings that I have come across of recent readings of Shakespeare's as a playwright, as a person. One reading says that Shakespeare was not a male, it was a female who had, probably transformed herself into a male. This is one reading that I found from a research project being taken up by one of the students of Leeds University, London. This is one. Second is one of the PhD scholars was pursuing his PhD again from, I think, I re don't remember the university, but some university abroad, stating that and trying to prove that Shakespeare himself was into a homosexual relationship. So, probably that could be, because of a self-projection kind of thing, which comes into his place. He's seeing himself through in his characters, so to some extent that, right? So,
I particularly, I specifically agree with Dr. Manish that yes, Shakespeare was fool, but fool, that fool has his own philosophy to demonstrate,
yes.
right?
There is a
So he
method in
was
his
a kind
madness.
of method. Yeah, there was
Yes,
some method
there
in
is
his madness,
method in his madness.
and his foolery was quite philosophical, and that's
Yes.
why we are talking about him, right? So
Yes.
is there anyone?
Sir, there is a question on YouTube. Praveen Kumar is asking a very general question. What is current research topics, or what are the current research topics to be done on William Shakespeare?
Oh goodness, now that would probably tantamount to a
Sir,
long discussion. But I can suggest to you that you could go to Infibnet Shodhganga and you could immediately, get a list of all the PhDs that are uploaded there. Because now UGC has taken up this project of even the last 10 years, PhDs, they are going to be getting uploaded on Shodhganga. So one should go to Shodhganga. And I am very sure, you'll be able to decide and come up with a particular
better
topic.
right.
Because see, taking up Shakespeare as a research, for your research is a little risky, as Jaswant sir also said, because there has been a lot of literature written on or available on Shakespeare. So you have to be very meticulous, you have to be very particular and very pinpointed when you are choosing topics. So we have to be very wary, because a writer who is very popular, there are chances, as Rathod sir also said, of plagiarism, because things have already been written. So I would recommend that it would be better you go to a website like Shodhganga and you just try to find out what are the recent trends in working on Shakespeare. So
Kindly refer to our concept note or a brochure made by Dr. will be shared by Dr. Tanvir Ahmad. We are planning to organize an international e-conference on Shakespeare, and you can find some topics as well as subtopics, right? And from that subtopics, you can choose your topic. Okay,
Oh,
so that's
that would have helped our
the
research. Yes.
that's ready-made material, sir. That's ready-made material.
Yeah,
So
Nirav.
just wait. Just wait.
Yes. I think I have something to
Yes,
share.
Nirav.
Yes, Dr. Kapoor, sir. First of all, am I audible?
Yes, sir. Clear. All.
Yeah.
Please
So,
go
first
ahead.
of all, let me congratulate you for the wonderful session. I think it was quite exciting and enriching in
Thank
every
you.
sense. You got
Thank
me
you so
reminded
much.
of my graduation days. I studied Hamlet in graduation almost 17, 18 years back. So you reminded me of that. So that's so
Oh.
nice of you and very
Thank you.
elaborate in
Thank you
your
so much.
presentation.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Let me come to my question. You talked about the love between Hamlet and Ophelia. So I think Shakespeare has presented women in a better highlight as well. But if we analyze Hamlet, if I see my perspective in Hamlet, and especially in the case of Hamlet and Ophelia, so I think I find Ophelia is somewhat presented as a character with lots of flaw. Maybe compared to Hamlet, she's not that much decisive. And maybe I should not use the word, but she's presented as a dumb character to Hamlet. Otherwise, she could have been presented as a somewhat moral support to Hamlet, since what he was passing through after his father's death. So when you talk about love, he could have been a moral booster for Hamlet. But in this case, I guess Shakespeare has presented the character in a very minor way. What's your take on that?
Okay. And the same kind of thing, I think even Jaswant Rathore sir was talking about. It would be a reiteration. So I would just say, Ophelia happens to be a 16th century woman, right?
Shakespeare
had no intention of showing her in a bad light. I fully agree. Yes, Hamlet needed the moral and mental support of Ophelia,
which
he does not get from Ophelia, just because, just like Hamlet, she is also torn between her duty as a daughter and as a beloved to Hamlet. As a daughter, she has to perform the duties that the father expects her to do, to be loyal, to be disciplined, and not to think of love, because she is a 16th century woman. And therefore, she has to remain well within the restraints of the social norms. And she was following that. And that is probably that. That is why, though she loves Hamlet more than Hamlet loves her, she is unable to express. And that is the reason for Hamlet's sorrow also. That he was seeking, this was the last, you know, piece, the last place where he could find love. And there also he feels a little taken aback when she does not respond properly. She is doing it deliberately. Why? Because she has been asked by her father to do so. That is the reason, you know. So not that she feels good about it, but she is supposed to perform this duty as a daughter. And that is the reason why she is not able to express her love. And finally, you know, neither is she happy, nor is Hamlet happy.
So that's why it's a tragedy. Rather
that
than
is it, right. It's a tragedy. A lot of piling up of dead bodies.
Yeah. Every character is feeling a emotion. Yes, definitely.
Sir, I have also a query, and I differ sharply from you about that. Your view about Rosencrantz and Guildenstern. Have they sacrificed, because they were also used as political tools, right, by Duncan. And that's why I don't think that they have certain values of friendship, all right, because they are not true friends of Hamlet.
What I feel is Rosencrantz and Guildenstern being very minor characters, being mere, you know, puppets in the hand of the king, they were almost like that. And therefore, even if they tried, they could not have gone against the king openly. So this, they did, the support that they had, Rosencrantz and Guildenstern had towards Hamlet, is like an indirect kind of support. So on the face of the king, they show that they are like they are with Claudius. But then, because they have spent their childhood days, as I have said in my presentation, that they have spent, they still have an amicable relationship. They still love, like not with they, but Hamlet, though being a prince, though being a rich and a renowned person, he is able to go down to that level and show his amicability towards these lower sections of the society, towards these, non-entity kind of things. And that is why they ultimately show their loyalty towards, they prove their loyalty towards Hamlet by getting murdered. They are murdered because it is discovered by Claudius that they are not spying on Hamlet. Rather, they are, you know, it is the other way around. Hamlet is using them as a tool, not Claudius. So that is the reason why they are murdered. And right. So that is my say on it.
Is there any question? Yes, sir. Tanvir, sir.
Sir, a YouTube Surya Tilagam says, Ruskin says Shakespeare has no heroes, has only heroines. Is it true in the case of play Hamlet?
See, what I would say is this statement stands true for the comedies of Shakespeare. Shakespeare's tragedies were hero-centric and Shakespeare's comedies were heroine-centric. So if you are applying this to Hamlet, I don't think, because there is no female character who is so dominant in the play, except for the fact that to some extent, Gertrude probably goes against the social expected norms and ends up getting married hastily, that she does. And otherwise, you know, but she, what you know, future holds for her, we all know, right? She is not happy. Neither is she able to win over the heart of the husband, the new husband Claudius, nor is she able to win over the son. She loses both of them that way. So I don't think that to call Hamlet a play where which is heroine centric, it is not. It would not be advisable to do so.
Even sir, feminists have also claimed that Shakespeare was, you can say, blaming women, and that's why Shakespeare used them as tools in his plays. What you said about Gertrude, na? Gertrude may succumb to the political power of the king. And that's right. Why she might have, you can say, surrendered to the wishes, or you can say surrender to the you can say desires of the king, right? And even in the case of Ophelia, he has also portrayed Ophelia as weak and Miss Tool, right? So both these women, feminists, as far as feminist criticism is concerned, they say that both these women are treated as you can say subject to the patriarchy. And they are just used as dolls or tools in the hands of men, and they are treated as something kind of you can say something toys, or you can say toys that can be used puppets that can be used particularly sexually. All right, and that's why you have that misdescription of, you can say, mother as well as the Ophelia. So affair between Ophelia and Hamlet, and affair between the king and Gertrude are also described in very, you can say, very unusual manner. All right, and that's why Shakespeare treats them.
To that, I would like to add, Dr. Rathore, that just as Shakespeare was looking out for everything related to human life, all emotions and, you know, passions and thoughts, you know. So even with respect to women, he was trying to portray women in all her shades, you know, and whether they are weak, whether they are dominant, whether they are, you know, charming, whether they are intellectually strong. Every shade, like if you look at the character of Portia in Merchant of Venice, she is a different, very strong woman. You know, she is a very strong woman, and probably you can, for her and Merchant of Venice being a romantic play, you can say, yes, it is a woman-centric play. We have Portia as a very important character. But vis-a-vis, as against it, you have the other play, say, Hamlet, where both these women characters, they are shown as weak. He is probably trying to explore all possible shades of womanhood in his place. That is what my style on it.
Yes. And what feminists say might be true, because in the case of, you can say, if particularly, specifically, we go, we examine Hamlet, we examine Othello, and we examine King Lear, the duty of woman is to woo men. Woo means to love.
Yes.
Yeah, that is what Shakespeare shown in his play.
I would also like to add, with all due respect to all the women in the house who are listening to me, please forgive me if I am saying something which is not acceptable or which is not permissible to you. But then this is one of the meanings of woman. Etymologically, when you read the word woman, it is, as you said, it is woe to men. That is, it is woe meaning. It is a kind of, she is a kind of, you know, a blotch on women. And women were supposed to, you know, that is the patriarchal meaning.
Yeah, patriarchal yes, kind of yes, mechanism is there. Your duty is to woo men. Your duty is to love men. All right?
Yes.
And love.
And it is a woe to men, you know. Yeah. She is like a woe to men.
And the male is also misconsidered to be the protector, right? Protector of that beautiful woman, right? That will be discussed in another webinar. Okay, is there any question?
If we have time, we again have a question from Surya on YouTube. Could you explicate the elements of Oedipus complex in the character Hamlet with evidences from play? I think this should have been answered during the webinar.
Yeah, I did, I think, mention that. See, if you again, to reiterate or to repeat, like if you look at Hamlet's character, right from the beginning, as I told you, Hamlet's sorrow. See, Hamlet, when the play begins, Hamlet is the only character who's still in his mourning garb, right? He's still wearing the black cloak. He's still in his mourning, whereas the other characters have come out of it. And he's still mourning. And when his friends, as I had shown in my presentation also, when his friends, you know, try to, like, Horatio also tries to ask him, like, why are you looking so sad? And then to that, he responds, he does not respond probably because he's not a man of words, as we say. He's a man of, you know, he's a man of words, he's not a man of action. And therefore, you know, he speaks very less. And, you know, what we find is he expected that after losing his father, whom he loved very much, he was desiring love from mother, right? And that at that point in time, you cannot say it was Oedipal inclination. It was as a child would expect love and care from the affection from the mother, he expects that, right? And because he does not get that from Gertrude, and he is all the more shocked by the fact that Gertrude, like, I am sad, I am feeling saddened by the fact that I have lost my father. And look at this woman, this lady Gertrude, who has lost her husband, who has been widowed. It has just been 2 months and she is getting remarried, right? And therefore, there is a reference which I used, that dialogue which I used, that do not go to the bed of, you know, wherein there was a reference to physical intimacy. He cannot, the son cannot, this son cannot stand, Hamlet cannot stand the even idea of any other man coming closer to his mother. And that is the prime reason why he fails in his relationship with Ophelia also. He is not able to give time and he is not able to give the kind of affection that was desired by Ophelia. And it is just because of his Oedipal inclinations, right? So therefore, there are many others that I could have spoken of, but then, you know, one has to keep in mind the time constraint also. So I could not incorporate, and then if I include all the more many, you know, speeches, then it would become pure, like, prosaic kind of approach. It would not be, become very interesting. So that was a deliberation on my part. I left out on some other kind of dialogues. And that is the reason why I might not have. Right?
May I ask one question, sir? Kapoor, sir.
Yes, sir.
Pratik bhai. Sir, my question is, that is a general observation from your side, sir. It might be Jaswan, sir, would like to give the answer the way Kapoor, sir, also. Sir, right now we are living in the world of, you know, I would like to say that the post-colonial, I would like to say the ultra-post-colonial era. So we are studying absurd drama, so one-act play, and, you know, the different form of the drama right now. So from your point of view, in this current era, how much Shakespeare is important for the students? Why still Shakespeare is alive? Instead, we can say that the many other dramatists, the modern dramatists. Definitely your whole session gives, we can say, that the answer, but I want your opinion, sir.
Okay. Sir, first you will answer, then I will.
Okay, fine. See, my stand, Pratik Bhai, on it would be that Shakespeare was and has been such a writer who has talked about, almost touched upon every aspect related to human life, right? And that is the prime reason for his popularity. Even after roughly 450 years that he has died, he is still being researched and he is still being read. That is reason number one. Secondly, all shades of all emotions, all thoughts. Now, Shakespeare never knew psychology, but in most of his tragedies, the best part of his tragedies lies in his soliloquies and asides. He was a very good, he was very good at understanding human psyche, and that shades of, you know, characters, negative, positive, and, you know, all shades of character. And that is probably, he has multi-dimensional kind of approaches. Shakespeare is there in literature? No. Shakespeare is there in economics. Shakespeare is there in every other discipline that you can think of. He's there in management. He's there in sciences also, you know, everywhere you can find Shakespeare. And you can, you know, it is just a way of probably tapping out the right kind of area and, you know, working for it. So that is why I feel that Shakespeare is still alive and very much kicking, and, you know, people are researching on Shakespeare. So that is my stand on it. Over to you, Justin.
Sir, It is very difficult to map out Shakespearean discourse, and that's why we have management Shakespeare, we have Shakespeare in economics, we have legal Shakespeare in law, right? And we have, you can say, medical Shakespeare and Shakespeare in pandemics, right? He has used the word, I think, more than 1600 times. The word plague is used in his plays, more than 1600 times. Right, so the word plague is there. If we connect Miss Corona or COVID-19 to the 16th century plague, right, and he can be interpreted in many ways. This is the greatness of Shakespeare. Actually, why he is great? Because he can be interpreted taking any kind of disciplinary, you can say, subject, or he is a kind of multidisciplinary area. Right, you can have colonial Shakespeare, you can have post-colonial Shakespeare, you racial Shakespeare, as well as you can say the critique of racism is Shakespeare. Right, you have capitalist Shakespeare, you have feudal Shakespeare, you have, you can say, neo-capitalist Shakespeare, you have that spiritual Shakespeare and Christianity.
Agree.
You have the violator of Christianity, you can say, you can find in Shakespearean plays, right? Even I have, see, I am going to miss on 8th, I have to miss defend myself and my thesis, right? I have pursued research work on, you can say, selected Shakespearean plays and Indian perspective. So I am examining Shakespearean plays from an Indian perspective. I said in my thesis that because Shakespearean characters have violated certain norms of karma, dharma, and all these things, Indian religious, spiritual concepts, that's why there is tragedy. So this fellow, Hamlet, forgets his own dharma. He violates the norms of dharma. All right, this you can Macbeth. Macbeth does not know what is his duty. His duty is to protect the king, right? And he violates. So yeah. And then the word dharma is not only, I can say, you cannot find one meaning of dharma. Dharma can be, you can say, defined in many terms, right? So dharma is your religious duty, your human duty, as well as it is you can say it is very shuttled word. Please read the text, you can say, Guru Charan Das, right? The difficulty of being good, right? Subtle art of dharma. Guru Charan Das is an executive, right? He is very eminent, you can say, management guru, right? So we will have all shades of Shakespeare, all interpretation, feminist Shakespeare, oh my God, right? Freudian Shakespeare, right? Psychoanalytic Shakespeare. So please come to our e-conference. I wish that Tanvir sir will explore more. All right. So we will open up.
And that is why Pratik bhai, Shakespeare is still plaguing us.
Yes. Okay. And see, many areas can erupt. Right, areas can erupt like volcano. He is you cannot stop him. Right, and if you read, I think that when I read Hamlet now, I have different interpretation of it. So every play, when you read Hamlet in your BA, right, that is a different text.
Yes,
when you read in MA, different text. And when you are teaching, that is different.
Yes, sir.
In 2019, I taught Hamlet, right? That was quite different text. If I will teach in 2020, so that would be my different text, right? That is the greatness. That is, you can say, significance of your Miss Hamlet. And that's why I salute to that man. He is a man of millennium, right? He's a writer of millennium. And that's why we are, see, I think we have passed 2 hours, but we cannot miss, we do not have the tiredness. We are not a boring, we can say, in a boring webinar, right? And we enjoy it, right? That's the greatness of man, right? Mm-hmm. Okay, is there any question?
Thank you.
Tanvi sir, no question. So, Dr. G.R. Parmar is with some government work, so I should thank, I should have missed so much respect for Dr. Kapoor, because he is my senior, and he has also motivated me a lot, and I thank him for this, you can say, presentation. He has provided us all shades of love, right, in Hamlet as well as in The Merchant of Venice. And it was enlightening. I should not, you can say, praise more, because the chat box is full of praise. It is, you can say, if you read the chat box, I can have many words, adjectives and adverbs, right? So I should not go through it. So, sir, thank you very much. Thank you all for you can say, your active participation. I have now my regular, you can say, participants, right? So I should not also thank them daily. So thank you all. It is your love, it is your inspiration, it is your motivation, and it is your respect for the knowledge, right? That brings you here on the webinar, because we are now in an era that can be called Digital India. And I think that COVID-19 has converted us digitally, and it has now inaugurated Digital India, right? So thank you all.
Thank you so much, Tanvir sir. Thank you so much, Rathore sir, for providing this platform. And thank you all the participants for this wonderful session.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.